I know Ken makes the case that this is a low fee, $0.6 a day. Sounds very good. But when you actually think about that and you have three children, that's pretty much the full salary or full income of a family living on a dollar a day in Ghana. This is not reaching the poorest. There's actually an interesting study of the Amiga schools in Ghana which showed that of 450 children surveyed, 449 of them had previously been in government schools. So this is not a means for extending access or extending provision. It is a means for helping those who've got some money get, supposedly, access to better education. Seems to me that we do know what to do to improve creativity and accountability in public education. There's a lot more that we need to do. There are major challenges ahead. But if we want to make a difference to the system for all children, as Gracia Michelle was reminding us today, it's not about benefiting a few who can afford to pay, but providing quality, creative education for all children, then we need to look at what we can do to reform public education systems.
I was involved in the design of Kenya's free primary education in 2002-2003. I was advising the minister and the government at that time. I was an advocate. I am a great critic of free primary education because of something Ken mentioned, that we need to connect costs with the service that we are getting. The moment you separate this, you get a big problem, something in economists know about, which is called fiscal illusion. People think it's free, they don't care much about it.
I think the low-fee private sector has a role to play. I'm not ideological about this. I just think we need to be open about who it is we're serving. We're not serving the poorest of the poor. And there certainly has been a grave injustice at the level of public and state provision that this is the kind of choice that families feel they have to make. It saddens me that that is where we've come to.
Something that we always ask ourselves before we're making decisions is, what's best for students, what's best for families, and what's best for our staff? On this question of low-cost private schools in general, the question of whether it's better for students, we've heard from Ken that it's undeniably yes, better, and we've heard from David that it's undeniably no, and I think there's evidence in there for everything in between. The next order question to me is what's better for families. There's going to be some group of families that's going to be able to afford a low-cost private school with no problem. There's going to be some group that's not going to be able to afford it. The group that's in between, the group that struggles to be able to afford it but makes it work, I don't know that we can argue that they're better off. They have less income. They might be better off 15 years from now when their kids are really well-educated and can bring that income back to the family. But for that 10 to 15 years where they might be struggling to really do that, it's a question of whether that's really a fair thing and whether that really does benefit families.
What we have learned from the largest RCT that compares the government schools and budget private schools, affordable private schools, that was conducted in rural Andhra Pradesh, that's Karthik Muralidharan's study, essentially tells us that both the government schools and the private sector schools are failing our students. The outcomes are just not good enough. It's just that the private sector manages to do this at one-third of the cost for various reasons. They prioritize different classes. Their cost structures are different. They and government schools, in fact, do leverage the services that are available to the village. The more interesting question here and is on, so we do know about learning outcomes, is on monitoring. Do private schools actually monitor their quality? And just very briefly, from your research and from your readings, how do they monitor their quality?
One of the problems we have in terms of this debate about public-private outcomes is the fact that we really don't have good data. And a lot of analyses are superficial. They just look at the scores and say the private school is doing well versus the public school. You really need to be careful about the type of studies that you really evaluate and look at the data they use. It has to be more than that. For example, one of the things that happens is sorting out, is that parents who are more motivated will tend to take the opportunity to go to private school. But like in the case of a public school, when you make it free, you get a new cohort of students, people who have been out of school system, older students, and so on. So how you evaluate public-private performance need to be informed by data, and you have to look at socioeconomic characteristics, you need to look at the household setting, you need to look at what is being offered within the school system. So it's really a more data-intensive task.
I think the debate needs to be, how do we build effective governance models within the public education system? And that needs to be of two types. One is the school inspectorate, so sort of top-down inspectorate, which is meaningful and actively engaged, and not just looking in assessment results, but looking genuinely in detail at the performance of the school. And active engagement of communities in tracking the performance of the school, not just whether their children are going to school, but getting into the detail of what's actually going on inside the school.
We need to get away from dichotomies. As I said, I've been working on this for 15 years, and about 3 or 4 years ago, I said to myself, I'm just not going to work on this anymore, because the discussion was just private versus public, private versus public. We need to move beyond that if really we're serious about creative solutions to systemic change. So I'll give you an example. The Rishi Valley method in India, which you would know, was a method that was devised really by private sector, but not profit, but private sector provision, looking very much at activities-based learning. This was a very small model. Over years, it got expanded into what's now called the activities-based learning approach. This was piloted in Tamil Nadu, which is the southern state of India, in Chennai, capital state of Tamil Nadu, in the Chennai Municipal Corporation's development schools. Now, I need to tell you something about MCD schools. They're universally panned in India. What happened was that the government, the MCD, and the government of Tamil Nadu got together and said, okay, let's pilot the Rishi Valley approach, but let's contextualize it for this particular area and come up with a new method. And this was the ABL method. They were sitting on the floor, teachers were engaged, they developed curricula, they developed activities, and this what we saw was an engaged system of learning. And what happened was that over the course of a few years, that system got rolled out into the MCD Corporation schools. And if it could happen there, it could happen anywhere. And this was a really good, you know, initiative that was started as really a private sector, small type of idea that then got scaled up.
What we're seeing is a lot of government officials have been coming to visit our schools. We have a very open door policy. We're happy to share best practices. We're happy to work with them on implementing this in their schools. And it's not just the technology, it's not just the activity-based learning. I think it's a confluence of different ideas. So I'll give you another example. And each of the ideas in our model, I know Omega calls it school in a box, we call it the school 360 for our schools, comes from something that we saw that was an issue. So we have locally hired teachers as well. They come from the areas that we hire in. And part of the reason we do that is because, one, there's no job creation in these areas. As Prachi said, they're cashless societies. Most people in the areas that we work are farmers. So providing job creation and training to go along with it is actually really important to helping the community as a whole grow. We also find that our teachers know our students, and know our students in a certain way that I've never seen. So I'll give you an example. When I'm going around visiting schools with a teacher, a management staff, our director, Daniel Mwanza, someone will stop a child that's not in school and say, why aren't you in school? This is what time your class is. Where are your parents? Why are you late? It's a level of oversight that I think is really incredible. It's not that our schools or our staff are serving the community. They are the community. And I think that's really crucial in some of these very rural schools.
I think the way we are looking at it is that it's a public school or a private school. Traditionally, that's not really what has been the case. What has been the case is a joint ownership between communities and the government playing some part. And people owned the school. So to me, it's not a question of public-private, it's to what extent does the community really feel that they own the school. Our parents actually own the schools.
I think we should absolutely focus on the sort of model which is free at the point of use, which is the model which Reshmi is talking about. It could be that there's a whole range of different providers who are involved in provision of education. Philanthropic providers have been working, faith-based providers providing education for a very long time. But it needs to be free at the point of use.